Just about now, Britain's Prime Minister is sitting down to dine with her fellow European heads of government here in Dublin. And the mood of that dinner party may well determine whether this two-day summit meeting ends in harmony or discord. Mrs. Thatcher knows that there is some sympathy amongst her European partners towards the problem of Britain's common market payments. But she wants much more than sympathy, backed as she is by overwhelming public opinion at home. The key statistic in Britain's argument with her partners is the net cost of her membership, and that works out as £1,145 million. We've broken that figure down to show what EEC membership costs an average family with two children in Britain and in the rest of the community. The cost is £1.58 per week for every family in the United Kingdom. The next highest cost falls on German families, who each pay £1.02 per week. And a long way behind are the Italians, 26p. But families actually gain from membership. For French families, this amounts to 66p per week. For the Belgians, £2. For the Dutch, £2.49. For the Danes, it goes up to £6.51. And the Irish, on whose territory the whole controversy has come to the boil, gain a whopping £11.65 per family each week from the EEC. So it's the dramatic contrast between what the common market costs Britain and what it costs her partners that Mrs. Thatcher regards as unacceptable and which she is determined to resolve here in Dublin. For TVI, Brian Gould has been looking at the options open to her as she seeks to negotiate. First, though, how does Britain come to be such a heavy loser? Our report begins at what's known in German as a Butterberg.
This is the fantasy land of the European Economic Community. Outside a small town in southwest Germany, a building whose purpose defies reason. Inside, it's butter. Boxes and boxes of it, stored and guarded in deep freeze security vaults. When people talk about a butter mountain, this is what it means. A specially designed and constructed building that holds butter the common market knows no one wants. This 8-story cold store is just one of the foothills of the common market butter mountain. But the huge importance of this building and many others like it is that it costs the common market a fortune just to store food surpluses, and it's Britain that foots most of the bill. Once a week, the experts arrive to see whether they can tell good butter from bad. All the butter put into storage goes through regular tests for taste and water content to make sure it's up to standard. If this butter can ever be sold, it will be at what everyone in the common market calls Russian price, a giveaway price, just to get rid of the stuff. And this expensive charade is going to get worse. Unless we act now, our 1.1 billion contribution will rise next year to as much as we spend annually on primary education.
But your figures for 1980 are based on the assumption, I mean, we don't yet know how much they're going to put the prices up in 1980.
I think it assumes that farmers, they keep agriculture price as the critical thing there. Mm-hmm. And they assume that
the Tory government is faced with its toughest test so far. We went to Cambridge University to ask, how tough can we be? Could it make economic sense to use the ultimate weapon, threatening to pull out of the common market? For TVI, the Cambridge University Economic Policy Group used their computer model of the British economy to calculate the consequences of withdrawal. First, we asked the policy group what would happen to food prices if we stayed in and if we came out. Before we joined, we were paying in today's money £23.40 for the family food each week. Now we're paying £26.25, but that figure could be brought down if we came out of the common market, to roughly what it was before we went in, a saving in the weekly budget for each family of £2.49, or a fall of 9.5% in the food bill. Then we asked what would happen to jobs and output in industry if we pulled out. Again, the policy group told us that we'd be better off. If we stay in, our industry gets weaker. In 5 years, 931 millions weaker. If we pull out, we could be better off. We'd be free to give government help to industry, or restrict the growth of common market imports, or make the pound more competitive. But many people still worry about how we'd get on, cut off from the world's largest trading bloc. They're afraid we might become a backwater and that we'd be ignored when it came to deciding where to put new investment. Take this British engine, made by one of the most successful American multinationals, Ford. How important is the common market to them? Ford's European headquarters are in Britain, but when it came to putting this engine into the car they hoped would scoop the European market, the engine had to travel to Spain. Ford built this brand new factory on the outskirts of Valencia 3 years ago, and 1,104 Fiestas are made here every day without fail. It's this productive potential that brought Ford to Spain, even though Spain isn't in the common market. But that doesn't seem to bother Ford. They have their own common market, covering Norway, Sweden, Spain and Portugal, as well as the EEC, so that when the Fiestas roll off the production line in Valencia at better than 1 a minute, it's hard to say whether the Fiesta is a common market car or not. Daily, the quayside is crowded with Fiestas, waiting to be shipped to Britain. The Fiesta may be regarded in Britain as a homegrown product, but over recent months, 7 out of every 10 new Fiestas on British roads have been made in Valencia. And all these have already been sold to waiting customers in Britain. It was this vision of productive vitality and huge Europe-wide markets which beckoned most British firms when we joined the EEC in 1973. But most British firms can't operate like Ford, and the dream for them has failed to become reality. The Cambridge Economic Policy Group rammed the point home. New export opportunities in the common market boosted our output all right, but our industry was knocked for six by the tidal wave of imports into Britain from other common market countries. The result? British industry is smaller and weaker than if we hadn't joined, and we have lost production worth £2,613 million in each year. Other countries have done better. The Germans seized their chance in export markets, and though imports have hurt them too, they have managed to hang on to a good share of their home market. So they're nearly £6 billion better off each year. The French have done the same, stacking up a £5 billion annual advantage. And even the Italians have made and sold more manufactured goods like cars and fridges worth £7 billion a year as a result of being in the common market. But Lord Plowden, president of Tube Investments and a member of the CBI's Europe Committee, is adamant that after the first 7 years of teething troubles, we must still make it work.
I always believed that one of the most strongest arguments for going into Europe was the fear of being left outside large trading blocs with the Japanese as our main competitors. And I think that still goes. If you went outside the common market today, you would be outside the largest trading bloc. You would have against you tariffs of, well, take bicycles, which is one of our products, 17% to get into the common market. Or clothes, men and women's clothes, 17%. Motor vehicles range from 11 to 22%. Well, we find it difficult enough to sell in the common market now, but if we had tariffs like that against us, it would be still more difficult.
How long do you think it will take before we actually start to see the real industrial benefits? Because they haven't yet become very apparent.
No, it takes time, because, I'll give you an example from TI. Bicycles are a large part of our, one of our largest exports. We export about 60% of the output. Not a great deal to Europe. And therefore we decided that we must exploit the European market, because some of our markets overseas were disappearing for the reasons I've given, people wanting to be self-sufficient and so on. We spent a great deal of money on a bicycle team, which last year won the Tour de France, which is one of the best ways of advertising bicycles that you can have. But the results take a long time of coming, because after all, the French and the Germans make bicycles, and very good bicycles. So I don't think you can put a time to it. I just think that it's going to need a great deal of hard work.
So his belief in our future in the common market is unshaken. But for the Germans, the industrial success of the past 7 years is real. They have made the common market work for them, with efficient factories like this Ford plant at Saar Louis, making yet more Fiestas. Unlike us, they have taken full advantage of the bigger market, so they add industrial success to the benefits they get from the agricultural policy, the best of both worlds. And that's the case for Oscar Niederkorn. He works full-time at Ford's and has done for the past 10 years. He earns a wage that would be the envy of a British car worker. He works the 2-to-10 shift, but after getting home at 11:30 at night, Oscar is up at 7 the next morning to start work with his one-cow milking machine. Oscar is a part-time dairy farmer. This is where the milk is produced to be turned into butter and to end up in the limbo of the deep-freeze butter vaults. Oscar has 7 cows, but only 2 are in milk at present. It's an operation so small that no British farmer could survive. But so efficiently have the Germans organized the common market subsidies to suit themselves that Oscar can earn another £80 a week. Without the subsidies, Oscar would have given up, and Mrs. Thatcher wouldn't be shaping up for a fight in Dublin.
Are you worried about the problem of surpluses?
Oh.
Yes, we are worried about surpluses and about the butter mountain.
But that doesn't stop you from producing more.
No,
we're increasing production.
The common market offers a grant to encourage dairy farmers to stop their production. Have you ever considered taking that grant?
Yeah, that's so.
Yes, I've thought about it.
But at the moment, it's still worth your while to produce more and more milk rather than take the grant.
If the price we get for the milk goes down, then it won't be economical to keep cows, and I'll accept the grant and stop producing milk.
How much land do you have here?
25 acres.
Does this fit in well with your job at Ford's?
I farm in my spare time. Working at Ford's is my main job. Farming is just my hobby.
But his milk helps Oscar to earn a good living. But what happens to his milk makes the story even worse. He sends his milk to the dairy factory 10 miles away. But there's not a big enough demand to cope with the never-ending flow of milk. In a desperate attempt to get rid of it somehow, the factory turns it into milk powder. The surpluses don't bother the 2,000 farmers who send their milk here. They're quite happy just to pick up their common market paycheck. The factory sold this butter to the Butter Mountain, or into intervention as it's called, at an artificially high common market price of £1 a pound. This Christmas, the Common Market Intervention Board who bought the butter have come up with an ingenious idea for getting rid of it. They are selling it back to the factory at 75 pence a pound, and the factory can then offer it to German consumers at a special low Christmas price. No one tries to hide what's happening. Indeed, the Christmas bargain is even called intervention butter. The fast doesn't seem to worry the Germans at all.
But can it be right to fix prices so high that it is worthwhile for a farmer milking only 2 cows to keep on producing milk very inefficiently?
Das ist ein sehr extremes Beispiel.
This is a very extreme example. There are different methods of production within individual EEC countries. Most farmers with only a few cows live in distressed areas and have no other way of earning their living. The only way to help them is to improve industry, create jobs, so that the small farmer can stop producing milk uneconomically. Alternatively, we can improve the situation by giving subsidies to encourage farmers to change from dairying to fat stock production.
If it is necessary to support agriculture in this way at a cost of about £6,000 million each year, do you think it's fair that Britain should pay the biggest contribution, since we are in fact doing our best to reduce the surpluses which actually cost all the money?
Über Belastungen einzelner Länder.
We can all argue about the financial burdens of our own countries. Nobody likes paying out a lot of money. But our government has been paying the largest contribution for a long time. And so we've supported the whole idea of Europe. In addition to this, I don't believe that Great Britain has such financial difficulties that she can't afford to pay her contribution. You have oil, for example, which we don't have. We should be able to reach a solution that keeps everybody happy. We don't want to put a greater burden on any country. That is not in keeping with the idea of a united Europe.
Fine words, but fine words weren't all that we were hoping for when we joined the common market. Like the Germans and others, we joined because we thought it would make us better off. In 1960, a British family had in today's money £74.39 to spend each week. The Germans had only £66.78, the French £61.61, and the Italians only £43.64. So we were much better off than others in Europe. By 1973, we were still ahead of the Italians, but the Germans and French were £8 or £9 a week better off. We thought that by joining the common market, we could catch up with them. But since we joined, things have got worse. The Germans and French have surged further ahead. The Italians are still closing the gap, but we have stayed more or less where we were. Now, you're a veteran of common market battles. What's the secret of success? What advice can you give her?
Secret of success is to be firm and reasonable and absolutely unyielding whenever you consider British interests, because every other member of the community is after the interests of their own country, and they laugh at you if you try and be soft with them. On the other hand, they respect you if you stand up for what you believe in. Within the context of the common agricultural policy itself, she can do what we started to do in March, and that is refuse to ratify any of the regulations which make the common agricultural policy legal. You see, they've got to be renewed every single year. So what she could do is say, no, I'm not going to do that at all. Now, that means that from that moment onwards, every country in the community has to subsidize its own farming out of its own national resources. We do it anyway to a great extent, but we're subsidizing all the rest of Europe too. So it wouldn't hurt us, it would hurt the others.
Could she just simply refuse to pay?
Well, she can do that too, but then there are disadvantages to that, because then other payments don't come back into Britain. And as far as the budget is concerned, it's the common agricultural policy that is the real villain of the piece. That's where we're paying out the money. So it would be much better from her point of view to say, let's try and get rid of the common agricultural policy. We won't renew the regulations.